After all the protests and political grandstanding, Team Djokovic's argument boiled down to this. Novak was denied procedural fairness by Border Force, who cancelled his visa before he could seek advice from Tennis Australia or his agent.
It was abundantly clear throughout that whole process that Mr. Djokovic wanted more time. There was no reason, no intelligible reason, not to allow him that more time.
He did get an opportunity to telephone his lawyers, but that was in the middle of the night.
Government lawyers argued that the Serbian superstar was never eligible to enter the country. According to Atagi's advice, Djokovic would only qualify for a vaccine exemption if he was suffering serious illness as a result of COVID-19. Evidence suggests that wasn't the case.
The key issue here is that up until the 5th of January, the policy at Australian Border Force was that it accepted medical exemptions provided by state governments at face value. But for some reason, on the 6th of January, that policy changed. The first application of that policy happens to have been Mr. Djokovic.
He had every reason to believe that he would be permitted to enter Australia when he arrived.
And the judge agreed.
The point I'm agitated about is what more could this man have done?
The world number one walking free late this afternoon. So will this court victory beget another?
Well, Renee Stubbs is a former doubles world number one. Renee, you couldn't make this up. What do you make of the way it's all played out?
Well, I think I can't really say it on the air, but it's a bleep show is what it is. I mean, it has been really for the last 4 or 5 days. It's an extraordinary moment, not only in sports internationally, but Australian sports. And really, it doesn't shine a great light on the Australian government, on the procedures that we've had to deal with through the last, well, 12 months, really, between the states and the federal government. And it's really outshone itself in this argument.
Well, speaking of the government, Immigration Minister Alex Hawke is now considering using his ministerial powers under the Act to cancel Djokovic's visa once again, which could see the tennis star banned from Australia for 3 years. What would be the fallout from a move like that, Renee?
That would be an extraordinary one. I think that he has to be really careful. In the next, 3 to 4 hours, we're going to see what the health minister does with this decision, because it does, you know, pose a threat to Novak of not being able to come back to Australia for that amount of time. And that could really threaten his Grand Slam, you know, total going forward, because he has at least another 3 to 4 years of good tennis left in him, or great tennis left in him. So, as I said, doesn't shine so brightly on the Australian federal government right now after this decision today.
Renee, there's been lots of talk about the government, state and federal, but let's talk about Tennis Australia. Do you think that they did enough in the lead up to this to prevent this situation happening?
I do. I think that knowing Craig Tiley the way I do, and also knowing some of the medical staff at the Australian Open, I know how fastidious they are. I know how much of a note-taker Craig Tiley is. I know that he would never jeopardise the number one player in the world, the 9-time Australian Open champion, without giving him all the information that he needed, without making sure and double-checking with the federal government. I heard that he double-checked certain criteria to make sure, look, this is OK, right? And when you think about the fact that there were already players in the country that were already here in Melbourne, that played an event on the same exemption of that Novak Djokovic was put on, and then now being deported out of the country. And the reason really they've gone is because they don't have the money to fight it, so in the court. So really, as far as I'm concerned, look, Tennis Australia probably could go back and maybe change a couple of things and maybe, you know, secondary them looking at it now through different eyes. But I think that as far as I know, from Tennis Australia's standpoint, they would have done everything possible to make sure that all the players were OK.
Renee, has this ruined Novak's Oz Open preparations, or has it really just put some fire in his belly?
Well, I think it's a bit of both, to be honest. I think that, you know, look, it's not ideal. He spent 4 or 5 days locked up in a pretty horrible hotel room. He would have only been able to do minimal working out in a room like that. He obviously hasn't been on the tennis court at all, and that is disastrous going into the tournament. Playing best of 5 sets for men takes a lot of, physicality out of you. He's probably one of the fittest, if not the fittest, tennis player in the world, and he knows how to deal with a 5-set match, but this is not ideal preparation. It's going to get very hot here in Melbourne. It already started today. So Not ideal, but I think as far as Novak's concerned, definitely will put some fire in his belt. And he's always been a person that plays better when he has a little bit of adversity. So just like Nick Kyrgios said, I wouldn't want to play him in the first round.
Renee, given now that you've seen all of the evidence, I just want to be clear about what you're actually saying to us tonight, because you don't blame Tennis Australia for this. Are you saying it was a political stunt?
I don't know. Yes. I mean, when it comes to the fact that on the 5th, everybody was in the country under the same auspice as what he was, and then all of a sudden January 6 rolls around and bang, he's now being told he can't come into the country. Look, I mean, I'm the type of person that would have said, look, get vaccinated to come into the country. That's the safest thing. It's what Rafael Nadal has said. It's what every single player really that's here has done. But he decided not to. He, you know, he claims that he had COVID and he has the paperwork to prove it during that time. So having said all that, no, I just think that this, you know, when you look at the polls and 90% plus Australians have said we don't want him in the country, I think that's a pretty good indicator for any politician to say, yep, let's not allow him into the country.
Well, it's going to be fascinating to see what the federal government does in the coming hours. But for now, Renee, thanks so much for your time.
You're welcome.